This is a company which was acknowledged by Professor C.K. Prahlad as among the best success stories at the bottom of the pyramid. His main contribution in his last years was on business at the fortune at the bottom of the pyramid. In that, this particular company, Jaipur Rugs, has been called an extraordinary example. Harvard University has also studied its complex and robust supply chains. But the unfortunate part is in India, business schools don't talk about Jaipur Rugs. Because we do not look at ways in which corporations have been successful by creating profits by addressing the base of the pyramid market. So let me tell you the story of Jaipur Rugs and how they've been able to be successful. In 1978, Nandakishore Chaudhary, who is popularly called Bhai Saab, and you can look him up, he tweets, he writes on LinkedIn, he's quite media savvy, but very traditional in his priorities. He started a business by taking a loan of 5,000 rupees from his father to set up a rugs manufacturing business in Churu, in Rajasthan. You know what is the distinction of Churu, of that place Churu? It is known for reaching 50 degree centigrade temperatures during the hot summer months. That's the kind of ecological hazard the people of that place face. He started a small business with two looms and nine weavers in the courtyard of his house in Churu in order to make rugs or carpets. 40 years later, he was working with 7,000 looms and employed 40,000 artisans who were providing products to 40 countries across the globe. Now, how was this possible? How did he do that? The whole objective, the whole business model was stakeholder centric. The objective was to empower the rug makers, the artisans. The objective was also to make it a profitable and sustainable business. So the first thing was training. Jaipur Rugs would provide training to the local artisans, free of cost. In fact, they would even get a stipend. And once their training was over, they were given opportunities to make these rugs at 3,000 to 14,000 rupees a month, which was nearly 30% above what they would otherwise make. In Orthodox Rajasthan, women were given an opportunity to be a part of the training programs and be a part of the rug making business, and today more than two-thirds of their artisans are women. What came out of this opportunity was they started earning money, they had greater command, or rather greater opportunity to participate in decision making inside families. Because they did not have the capacity to, or did not have the opportunity to earn money, they did not have the right to participate in family decision making. With the capacity to earn came the opportunity to participate in decision making, and led to an improvement in their status in the villages. You see, the whole today we are a privileged class sitting in an air-conditioned classroom of a premier business school in Bombay. We do not realize the kind of inequities that are there, and if businesses try to focus on those inequities and use the skills and competencies of the people at the base of the pyramid as a part of their business, they are not only going to get committed people, they are also going to be empowering them. If we target the right kind of people as a part of your value chain, the impact that can have on your business is phenomenal. So one thing is that what Jaipur Rugs did. The second thing is they wanted to create value for the customers. Because if the customers are not going to buy these expensive products, they are not going to be able to give employment to these 40,000 artisans. So the customer centricity of the Jaipur Rugs model was such that they ensured they use superior quality yarn and silk, but they communicated that to their customers. Because what happens, a carpet is a product where you do not know the quality immediately. After 2 or 3 years, it will start opening up. Warranty period is over. Whereas a good carpet lasts for 2 generations, at least 50 years, and I have had personal experience, because there was a carpet in my house for almost 50 years. So a good carpet, so how do you distinguish between the two, right? Only time will tell. So they used to upfront communicate to the customers that our products are going to last for this long, and that's why we are charging more, because we use high quality products. The other thing is, how do you ensure quality across 40,000 artisans? So they effectively used IT to ensure the source of quality of each product, as to which is the artisan which is making this particular rug, and hence ensure that if there is a quality problem, it can be traced to an appropriate artisan in the rural areas. You can imagine they are working in hundreds of villages across 5 states. But effectively they used IT. Then how do you make these products sustainable in terms of sustainable sales, not environment sustainability, sustainable sales, is when you try and contemporize the products to the requirement of the international audience. How long will they buy product in order to cater to a bichara audience? Very often what happens in a social enterprise, it's helping someone. You have these people on the road when you are traveling in a car, selling you agarbatti or earbuds. You may buy from them once or twice, but that's not a sustainable model for them or for you, because that's not going to be of the quality you are used to, nor is it going to be giving them the kind of returns that they have helped them sustain themselves. So the bichara products are those which do not contemporize the product to the requirements of the end customer. Khadi for a long time faced that problem, because khadi was an embodiment of India's freedom struggle, but over a period of time it forgot to make itself relevant to the changing generations. Today it has. If you go to most khadi stores, the kind of products they now have are what millennials and the young workforce would like to wear. So they got in international design experts who were designing their carpets in such a way that they become more relevant to the Western audience. And finally, what they would do is, along with the carpet, they would send a photograph of the family which had made that carpet. So that particular family in Texas or in New York knows that this particular family in Churu in Rajasthan has spent 6 months collectively to make this rug, and by buying this rug they have empowered another family in another part of the globe to live a respectable life. So that was a very strong brand communication they did, and their objective or their communication point was that you are not just buying rugs, you are empowering a family. So you see how an entire social enterprise can use all the principles of management, can do everything that's necessary in order to make the business sustainable and successful, but at the same time remain loyal to its core objective of social well-being and the well-being of all the stakeholders. They are not doing any of these things at a loss. They reported a turnover of more than 150 crores in recent years. And as I said, they were acknowledged among the best businesses at the base of the pyramid. But their social objective, their stakeholder centricity and the sustainability of the product and the business was extremely well taken care of. So this is what happens when purpose is embedded in the objective of the organization.